chapter 3 this morning, verses 14 through 19. Feels good to get back to normal. You know, it seems like it's been about a month of just not happening. The whirlwind is over. Back to normal. So Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14 through 19. You know, I don't know about you, but I love it when people pray for me. And I'm sure everybody does. For people to pray for me. People say they're praying for you is a good thing. And you know, when people say, hey, I'm going to pray for you, you know, we hope that they're praying for us when they say that. Sometimes, you know, it's just good when you're going to pray for somebody, just to pray for them right there. You know, and then you guys remember to pray for them. But you know what? It makes you feel special when somebody is praying for you, doesn't it? You know, they take their time out of whatever schedule, whatever they're doing, to think about you and pray for you. That's special. Very special. Makes me feel pretty special. Well, so why am I sharing that this morning? Because the Apostle Paul has specifically prayed for you and I in our text today. He's prayed for us. What that means is it's a Holy Spirit-inspired prayer because it's the Word of God. In other words, it's going to be God's will for your life and my life as he prays this. That means as we submit to him and as we believe it, receive it, it's going to be true. It's going to happen in our lives. His will for our lives. You know, in 1 John 5, verse 14 and 15, it says this, this is the confidence which we have before him, that if we ask anything according to his will, don't ever forget that. Some people pray and think it's their own will that's going to be done. He hears us, and we know that he hears us, and whatever we ask, we know that we have the request which we have asked from him. And that's something you can claim. You know, the name and claim it doctrine and stuff. Anyway, you can claim that one. If you ask anything that is in his will, it's in his will. It's going to happen. He claimed this for you, because it's his will for you. Now, the first three chapters of Ephesians, it's about what God has done for us. That he gave himself up for us. The things he's done for us. Some of the scriptures that we looked at is Ephesians 1:3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. He's blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ. I'm not going to get into it. We already looked at that. Wow. Don't forget about that. Ephesians 1:7, it says, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace, the forgiveness of our sin. That's what he's done for us. Ephesians 2:13, but now in Christ Jesus, you who were formerly, were far off, have been brought near by the blood of Christ. You've been brought near to God. You've been brought back to God by the blood of Christ. That's huge, what God has done for you and I. And sometimes we just go through the world and forget about it. We don't remember that, but that's huge. Remember, he found us. We cannot find him. He did it. It's his work. Ephesians 3:6, he said, to be specific, that the Gentiles are fellow heirs and fellow members of the body and fellow partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. In other words, he has taken us, Gentiles, and made us one and equal with the Jews. We're all one. All cultures, all races, we are one in Christ. No difference. Nobody better than another. So the first three chapters, that's what they're about. And then chapters 4 through 6, it's how we are to be living our lives now because of that. Because of those things. then he took a little sideline from 2 to 13, and now, in verse 14, he's coming back to the prayer for you and I, and all believers of all time. It's a wonderful prayer. Let's look at it. Verse 14. It says, for this reason, Paul speaking, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in the inner man, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, and the length, and the height, and the depth, and to know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled up to all the fullness of God. And that's his prayer for us. Let's pray. Lord, this is your word. This prayer is for us. So Holy Spirit, I ask the Lord, you would teach us, and minister to us this week, and show us, each one of us, what we need to hear this morning from this prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Wonderful prayer. You know, I look at it, I see there's a lot in it. I see three basic requests in this prayer. And the first one is this in verse 16, that the Holy Spirit would strengthen you with power. The Holy Spirit would strengthen you with power. You know, that's what we need in our lives. We need the power of God in our lives. You know, I can't stand up here and open God's word and speak without God doing it. His power, I can't do it. It's his word. I need the Holy Spirit to empower me, to strengthen me, to be able to stand before you, right? Or to even lead worship, or to pray. He has given us the Holy Spirit so we can have a new life. Ephesians 1:13 again. In him, you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having also believed, you were sealed in him with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is given as a pledge of our inheritance, with a view to the redemption of God's own possession to the praise of his glory. He's given you, and you've been sealed by the Holy Spirit. I've been sealed by the Holy Spirit. As a promise, I'm going to return. I'm going to live. That's what it said. Then he empowers you to live this life, to overcome sin in your life, to have victory in your life, and to do his will in your life. He does that, it says there in verse 16, where it says, he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in the inner man. The inner man. You know, the inner man is used a few times in the New Testament. One other I want to look at was 2 Corinthians 4:16. Paul, by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, says, therefore we do not lose heart, but though our outer man is decaying, yet the inner man is being renewed day by day. The outer man is decaying. What is the outer man? This. It's decaying. It's dying. You know, I don't know where the turning point comes, you know, where you go so far and you're young and young, and all of a sudden it starts going like that. It's like when if you've been on an airplane, you know, you've been on an airplane, you know, they go up here, and they level off a while, and then the motors cut down, boom, and you start getting sick. It's kind of like these bodies. You know, I don't know what age where we peak. But it seems like the minute we're born, we're destined to die, aren't we? I've shared with you many times. I was just 18 the other day. That's only a couple years older than you. Now my brain feels like 18, but my body feels like, you know, 22. Plus a few. You see, the inner man is the eternal you, the real you. This is gone. It's going to be redone, right? This is, the inner man is the real you. See, this dies, but you keep living. You do not die spiritually. You shed your body, and the real you is what's left. It's left and keeps on going. spiritual life that lives on, okay? That's your connection with God, the spiritual you. You know, the natural man, you know, can't even touch the inner man. And most people in the world don't even know anything about the inner man. They don't know about their spiritual life. They don't know. They're just going through life, what they can feel, what they can touch, what they can see. That's all there is. And there's a whole eternity. And you, as a born-again believer, should know that there's more to life than this. There's an eternal life. Eternal life. And either we spend an eternity with the Father, with Jesus, or we don't. That's the decision of each person who's born has to make in their life. So how does he strengthen you? How does it happen? You know, number one, I believe it comes from a surrendered life to Jesus. Strengthen, how does he empower you? How does he strengthen you? When you surrender your life to Jesus, when you submit to the Lord in your life, then you just ask him, Lord, strengthen me, empower me, fill me with your Holy Spirit. And if you're walking with him, he's going to do it because that's his will to do that. Now, you need to empty yourself out. I mean, if you're clogged up with sin and garbage in your life, there's no room to be filled with the Holy Spirit because you're all clogged up. I have a drain at home. It's slowly, slowly clogging up. It's going down slower and slower. And I've just been too lazy to get it taken all apart from me, but it's clogging up. And pretty soon, nothing's going to go down. And that's how it is in our lives. We need to take those things in our life that are in the way, surrender them to the Lord. Let him forgive us by his blood because he forgave us and died for us. And surrender, and then he takes it, you're emptied out, and then be filled with the Holy Spirit. Let him empower you. And you feed the Spirit. You have to feed the Spirit. Here, my apple. You eat food, don't you? Well, you have a spiritual life that needs to be fed. Reading the Word, praying, worshiping, fellowshipping, resting in the Lord. Reading the Word, feed the Spirit of God in your life. So you're alive spiritually. Now, we starve our spiritual life by staying away from God's Word. You starve it. And then you go through life wondering, how can I just keep doing the same thing over and over? I keep falling. It's like, worth it because I can't do it. Well, you got no strength. You know, if you don't eat any food, you're going to die, right? You wonder why you can't get out of bed. You haven't eaten. It's the same thing. Feeding the Spirit. But I prayed. I want to stop doing stuff like that. Remember, you read God's Word. Be strengthened. Very important. Be empowered by the Holy Spirit. And be continually filled with the Holy Spirit. Continually. I ask every day. I probably, maybe I miss it. I can't remember. But you know what? Lord, fill me with your Spirit so I can stand up here and speak the Word of God to your people. God, fill me with the Holy Spirit so you can get me out of bed and use me today. God, fill me with the Holy Spirit. Forgive me my sin all the time. During the day. Oh, Lord, forgive me. Fill me with the Holy Spirit. Because you know, when you give out spiritually, you need to replenish. Continually be filled with the Holy Spirit. So, number one, then, that the Holy Spirit would strengthen us. The second thing that I see is in these verses here is so that Christ may dwell in your hearts. Right there, verse 17. So that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge. So the second thing I see here is be strengthened in Christ, so that he, in the Holy Spirit, so that he will dwell in your heart, so Jesus will dwell in your heart. You know, you can ask a little kid, you know, that's gone to church. Where does Jesus live? In my heart. Because that's what we teach him, right? Well, why do we teach him that? Well, the Bible says he lives in our heart. So that Christ Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. And you believe it by faith, don't you? I know that my life changed when the Holy Spirit came and resided in my life. My life changed. All of a sudden, I could be set free from things that I had dealt with in my whole life. I couldn't deal with before. Might have stopped doing. And so, you know, I had the strength to overcome some of those sins in my life. It was the Holy Spirit. It was Jesus in my life. See, He lives in you. Guess what? When you first give your life to the Lord, He lives in you just the way you are. He doesn't say, okay, clean your life up right now and then I'll come in. Give Him your life. He'll clean it up for you. See, when He moves in, He starts residing in you. What He wants to do is, He wants to rearrange the furniture in your life, in your heart. Those of you men who are married, at least you know, culturally in the States, it's that way. Wives are the ones that change and rearrange the furniture all the time. No, they rearrange it because they want it to look nice. And to look, you know, they change things around. And they say, oh, they want to get new wallpaper. You know, they rearrange the furniture so things are look good. But that's all the Lord wants to do in your life. He wants to rearrange the furniture in your life so that you can know Him, walk with Him, change things up. You see, John 14:23, Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our abode with him. He'll come and live in you. God Himself lives in you, believer. Believe that in faith. Listen. So what's that mean? It means everywhere you go, He goes. Right inside. Whatever you do, He's right there with you, right? Take that one. Okay? So this is what Paul prayed for us. That Jesus would live in our hearts. That we'd be empowered and strengthened by the Holy Spirit. And along with that, it's that we will be rooted and grounded in the love of God. Rooted and grounded in the love of God. In other words, knowing that God loves you. How deep? How deep? How do you really know it? Or are you, I hope He loves me. Or do you know it? That's what he's praying. Do you really know that God loves you? That those roots would be deep, His love for you. That you know who He is. You know, something about roots. You know, the palm trees here, I understand. One of the reasons, like when the big storms come, there's still palm trees left, because their roots go deep. I read that the roots can be bigger and longer than the palm trees. And that's why they stay up. Now you take in Tahoe, where Miss Ann and I are from, and we have pine trees there. Now pine trees, if we planted them out in the same place next to a palm tree, and those winds came, those pine trees are going, bam, man, they're going over. You be rooted in this God. So the roots will be deep, so you know that you know that He loves you. I love Psalm 1, verses 1 through 3, where it says, how blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law he meditates day and night. He will become like a tree firmly planted by streams of water, with which yields its fruit in its season, its leaf does not wither, and whatever he does, he prospers. That's because that tree is planted by the water, and the roots go deep, man. Solid. Firm. Continues on right there. In verse 19, it says, and to know the love of Christ. Surpasses knowledge. In other words, when surpasses knowledge, man's mind. You go and tell somebody Jesus is in their heart, you're like, yeah, I'm right. You're too little. Jesus is in there, you explode with a person inside you, because you know their mind can't comprehend someone living in you, especially God living in you. People can't understand them. But you know it, because you've experienced it. You know what he's there. You know, it's a love that's inexpressible. You just don't know. It's full of glory. It says it there in the Word. It's full of glory. The breadth, the length, and the height, and the depth of his love. It talks about, but listen, the breadth of his love, it reaches all. It's bad. The breadth of his love. No favorites. Equally love everyone. The length of his love. It's an enduring love, and it's an eternal love. It's going to last. It will always be there, God's love. The height of it. It will overcome any obstacle in your life. The height of God's love. Anything that comes your way. And the depth of it. It's there all the time. It's deep. It's not going away. Oh, I love the story of the prodigal son. And the prodigal son, you know, he takes his inheritance a little bit early. He goes out, parties down, dude. Blows all the money, man, but he has a good time, you know. He makes all kinds of friends until his money's gone. He's left alone. He got no food. He's out feeding the pigs. He starts eating the pig slop because he's got no food. Oh, man, what am I doing? I should go home. I could at least be a slave, a worker for my father. And he goes home, and where was his father? Waiting for him. Waiting for him. His father probably every day went out to look. My son coming. Boom, man. The father. That depth of love. Waiting for his son to come back, to return. Wow. That's good. And then he continues there in verse 19. It says, and to know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge, and to be filled up with the fullness of God. The third thing, I see here, to be filled up with all the fullness of God. To have everything God has for you. Everything. Spiritually. That's an incredible request. Paul's asking for us. To be full. Filled up with the fullness of God. So how does that happen? Be filled up with him. Well, that is all the things that we've looked at, we've talked about, you know, knowing him, surrendering your life to him, reading his word, walking with him. You know, David did, and David in Psalm 23, he said, my cup overflows. He was overflowing with the fullness of God in his life. My cup overflows. I'm so blessed. Everything God has for me. I heard the story of a man who was a street person, a bum in the States for years. And he was like the prodigal son was. And he had lost everything. He was starving. He had nothing. But on one day, out of desperation, he was in a park and there was a man sitting on the bench. He went up and he tapped him on the shoulder. Sir, can I just have a dime, 10 cents? And the guy turned around and looked. Jumped up. My son, I've been looking for you for 18 years. Oh, my son, everything I have is yours. You just have to receive it. That's what God's saying to us. Everything he has is ours. It's for us. Jesus has everything for you. My son, my daughter, I have it for you. But we have to receive. We have to believe it. God wants you filled up with himself. Some of us are so full of ourselves sometimes. We need to get rid of it, right? I know a lot of times I am. God wants to fill you up with himself. The love, the joy, the peace that is in Jesus, God has for you. It's love. It's joy, it's peace. And that's just beginning of what is to come for us. Throughout eternity, you know, we looked at that in the last few weeks. You know, we can't even comprehend what God has in store for his children. time right now, and I will not complain. I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go. I'm selfish. I'm sorry. Lord, save the other people later. I want to go home. Romans 8:29. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his son, so that he would be the firstborn among many brethren. Philippians 1:6. For I am confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day of Christ Jesus. I love that scripture. He promises that he starts this work in you, he's going to complete it. I saw him start this work in me when I was 12 or 13 years old, and I had a lot of rough years in between. But you know what? I watched him continually draw me back to himself, continually just love on me, pour out his blessings on me, change me. Now that was a couple of years ago, 55 years ago, started the work. And he promises to complete. And guess what? He's not done yet, this works. I'm not perfect yet. But he's going to perfect me. Until the day of Christ Jesus. And I, when I stand before him, I will be perfect because he's going to make me perfect. I can't do it myself, I'll tell you. Not many things I can do by myself. I could quit drinking, I could quit doing drugs, I could quit smoking, I could do anything. I tried. He can do it in your life. Give it to him. Sincerely. But get along. Go home. Get along. Say, Lord, I'm dealing with this in my life. I'm giving it to you. And I believe you're taking it. And just receive his forgiveness. Be filled with the Spirit. And then walk out and take it back again. And then give it back to him. Because that's what we do, don't we? And then one day, guess what? You give it to him. And then you don't take it back. That amazes me. You know what amazes me right now? It amazes me that I don't smoke pot anymore. I can think there would be a day in my life that I would never smoke. I would smoke pot every day of my life. That's what I thought. And I look back and go, I don't smoke pot. I don't smoke cigarettes anymore. I didn't think I'd ever be able to quit that. But that day came. When I surrendered it to him, that was it. But I had to keep doing it. I had to persevere. I couldn't stop. I'd get frustrated. I'd be bummed out. Lord, what's the use? Sometimes it's, why do I even know you? Because I know you, so if I didn't know you, I could party down and not have to worry about anything. You know, I could just go straight to hell or whatever, you know? I wouldn't have to deal with it, but since I know you, I'm convicted. You know, all of you know it, know what I'm talking about. But the things you struggle with, it's like, can't get away with it. Because he loves you. He's perfecting that work in you. He's convicting you. He's drawing you to himself. 1 John 3:2. Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not appeared as yet what we will be. But we know that when he appears, we will be like him, because we will see him just as he is. Whoa. When he appears, we will be like him. Wow. Be strengthened in the Holy Spirit in the inner man, so that Christ might dwell in your heart through faith and be filled with the fullness of God. Receive those, that prayer, because that's God's will for your life. Because we read the scripture, anything that is his will, he will do. If you just receive, now you can say, oh, that was good. I like that stuff. But you can just leave it there. You can be like that man who looks in the mirror, sees himself and has to go back and look at it again, or you can receive it and apply these things in your life and walk out of here and go, wow, I'm filled with your fullness, Lord. I'm going to walk differently. I'm going to walk with you. I'm going to know you, Lord. I'm going to be empowered by the Holy Spirit because you said so. Paul prayed it for me. Listen, you can go talk to somebody right now. They're going to think you're nuts. Yeah, I just came back from church, and guess what? Paul prayed for me. St. Paul, the Apostle Paul, he prayed for me. They're like, what? You're at that wacky church up there, huh? No, you read it for me. It's Paul prayed for me. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this prayer. We ask, Lord, that you would minister it to our hearts, that we would know it deeply in our lives, and the Lord would walk in it. We thank you for your love, Jesus. I know, Lord, we struggle sometimes. It's hard, Lord. But as we surrender, we keep surrendering, Lord. You strengthen us. You give us victory. You empower us. So I pray for us this morning, Lord. Maybe we're just going to start that journey today of really surrendering, really giving it to you, really receiving these promises. Show your mighty hand in our lives, Lord. Reveal yourself to us in ways we've never known before. And at the same time, then, Lord, use us to share with others that need to hear it.